In this session, I want to talk about rules for reasoning from Scripture, because it's obvious, you know, I'm sure from the early classes in this session, that both those who would identify with the Calvinist theological system and those who do not identify with the Calvinist theological system appear, in many cases, to be to have the Bible on their side. And yet, Calvinism and non-Calvinism cannot both be true, because they are simply contradictory to each other. In fact, non-Calvinism is nothing else but a denial of the points of Calvinism. And the Calvinism points can't be true and untrue at the same time. There might be some elements of truth and other elements of error in a given statement, but the statement as a whole cannot be true, or the concept that it's stating cannot be at the same time true and untrue. Therefore, we have a dilemma. We have persons on both sides who believe in the Scriptures, who wish to honor God, who are in every case, or at least on both sides of the issue, intelligent, and yet who reach wildly different conclusions, mutually exclusive conclusions. It's enough to make a person really despair of even studying the Scripture. What's the point? I mean, if you can conclude entirely mutually exclusive propositions from the same Bible, what's the point even of studying it? Well, the point of studying it is so you don't make the mistake that one of those two sides must certainly be making. It's clear that the Bible, if it's the Word of God, does not teach contradictory things. And therefore, if Christians have reached contradictory conclusions, then one, at least one, of those sides must be reaching the wrong conclusions and must be understanding something incorrectly. Now, that should not be altogether surprising to us that is possible to do. There are a wide variety of interpretations of some passages of Scripture. There are passages like Paul's statement about those who are baptized for the dead, for example. In 1 Corinthians 15, it is said there are no fewer than 40 different interpretations of what Paul meant by that. In the commentators that are available on 1 Corinthians 15, no fewer than 40 different interpretations have been given that one verse. Now, the fact of the matter is, that verse is more ambiguous than most. It is not the case that you could take most verses of the Bible and come up with 40 different interpretations of them. That particular verse is unusually ambiguous, and fortunately for us, it is a verse that not a lot hangs on it. I mean, if we understand it correctly or incorrectly, it doesn't change a great deal in the way we live our lives for God, and it is certainly not one of those things essential for salvation. But knowing God is an important thing, essential even. I'm not sure how many things we can believe wrong about God and still be saved. I suspect that our knowledge of God can be imperfect, I hope. I mean, I hope it can be imperfect and we're still saved, because all of us, we do have imperfect knowledge. Paul said we know in part and we prophesy in part. It's when he who is perfect comes that we'll see him face to face and we'll know even as also we are known. Our knowledge of God is imperfect. The question is, how many imperfections can be tolerated in our knowledge of God? If a person believes that there are four members of the Godhead or five, that is a view of God that probably is so far afield that holding that view, one could not really say that's the real God. I mean, you don't really know God at all. If you believe in a God who is physical and lives on Mount Olympus and governs a bunch of lesser gods, then once again, you don't know, your views about God are so far wrong that you don't know him at all. On the other hand, if a person uses the Scripture and sees it as God's revelation of himself, of his purposes, of his heart, of his character, and so forth, although it is possible to not reach exactly the same conclusions as other people who use the same book, it is not possible to reach infinitely different conclusions. That is, it's not an infinite number of possibilities. The Bible is specific enough to prevent this from being the case, but there are at least two, if not maybe even a few more possibilities. And the Calvinist view of God and the non-Calvinist view of God are essentially two options that seem to be able to be derived from Scripture, but that doesn't mean that both of them are equally valid or that both of them are taught in Scripture. The fact that people can come up with 40 different interpretations of one verse suggests There must be right ways and wrong ways of understanding certain verses. There must be a right way to discern what a verse means and a wrong way to discern what it means. And that following the right way, generally speaking, will help to glean the correct information that the verse was intended to reveal. Using wrong methods will perhaps prevent us from discovering that information. It is my contention that either the Calvinist or the non-Calvinist is using the Scriptures wrongly. I do not say that either side is doing so on purpose, and I don't think that either side has such a heretical view of God that God cannot forgive it and that a person cannot be Christian and hold this or that view. Because the essential points, the most essential points about who God is and what kind of a God He is, are largely agreed upon by all Christians, Calvinist or otherwise. But there are some rather important issues, like whether God wants all people to be saved, or whether God controls all things and is therefore in some unavoidable sense the author of sin as well as the author of righteousness. These issues do have something to say about the character of God, and therefore they are not matters so light as to say, well, why bother with this information? This is important information. And therefore we should employ every reasonable rule of interpretation that makes sense for reasoning from the Scriptures to know which is the correct way of understanding God. Now, I asked a question. I don't know if I gave it a thorough enough answer. At the bottom of page 3 of your notes, what is at stake here? What really is affected by your adopting a Calvinist view that would be affected differently if you did not adopt a Calvinist view? Well, there might be any number of things, but not all the things that Calvinism can be accused of are valid criticisms. For example, some people say if you believe in eternal security, that you'll just go out and live in sin. Well, this is not a valid criticism. It may be a valid criticism of one form of the doctrine of eternal security that is taught in some circles today, but it is certainly not a criticism of Calvinism, because Calvinism in no way makes it okay to live in sin. Calvinism does not teach a doctrine of eternal security that says you can sin and still be saved. Calvinism teaches the doctrine of perseverance of the saints, which says if you go ahead and live in sin, you aren't saved. You show whether you are elect or not by not going out and living in sin, by living for God. That's the only way you know for sure if you are elect. And therefore, it is a cheap shot and not a legitimate criticism to criticize Calvinism this way. On the other hand, if somebody says, well, if you're not a Calvinist, then you have eternal insecurity. And this is a humorous term that Calvinists sometimes use for people who are non-Calvinists. We, they say, believe in eternal security. You must believe in eternal insecurity. But this is not the case either. This is not a correct representation. It is not so that a denial of Calvinism must necessarily lead to insecurity about one's salvation. As a matter of fact, it seems to me the tendency would be the other way, and I'll tell you why. There are, I think, if a person takes his theological system to its logical conclusion, there are two unavoidable issues that are affected by this theology, both of which are important issues. One, of course, is our view of God. Someone was telling me the other day that they were talking to an unbeliever. In fact, they talked to quite a few unbelievers recently, and they noticed that almost all the objections to Christianity that the unbeliever was bringing up were actually not objections to Christianity, they were objections to Calvinism. The unbeliever didn't know this. The unbeliever didn't know what Calvinism is. It's just that predestination and some of these issues and God controlling everything were issues that these people had heard only from the Calvinist side, and they found reason to criticize Christianity. Whereas if they had actually known what the Bible teaches rather than what Calvinism teaches, they might not have criticized God. Our view of God can be impugned this way. You know, the Calvinist believes that they alone sustain the high view of God because they impute to God a degree of sovereignty much more absolute. One might even say more extreme, although they would not use that term, but more absolute view of sovereignty than the non-Calvinist does. After all, God gets all the credit for everything that happens because He makes it all happen. The problem with this is that not everything that happens is good. And therefore, this cuts two ways. If we wish to give God all the credit for the good things that happen, because he makes everything happen, then he must also take the responsibility, one might even say blame, for things bad that happen. Now, I would not use the word blame in this case, because even if God were responsible for the bad things that happen, rather than blame him, I'd say, well, that's his business. If he wants to make bad things, he can make bad things. He's God. But the problem is, the Bible does not reveal such a God. If God is such a God as ordains bad things to happen, if God has in fact chosen by a unilateral, totally sovereign, unaffected by any other circumstances than his own sovereign good pleasure, if he has chosen that millions of people should be damned without ever a hope of salvation, without, even if they hear the gospel, they don't have any hope of accepting it because they don't happen to be elect, then this is definitely a kind of God that differs from the God believed in by the Arminian or the non-Calvinist, and arguably it differs from the God that expresses himself and reveals himself in the Bible. And therefore, one's view of God, we have a high view of the sovereignty of God, which means that we extend the sovereignty of God to every decision, every act, everything that happens. It's all what he ordains, including all your decisions, including your decision to go to hell. He ordained that you'd make that decision. Well, that may seem, well, we've got a very lofty God. We've got a very powerful God. We've got the biggest God in all theology. Well, no, not any bigger than the God of the Muslims. They've got an Allah that does all that too. Allah wills it. Allah wills it. You know, people kill and get murdered and stuff. Allah wills it. Everything's got the will of Allah. Actually, the God of Calvinism is not the loftiest God in the pantheon of available gods and religions of the world. The Muslims have a God every bit as big, just not as biblical, you know, because the God of the Calvinists certainly has more biblical traits than the God of Islam does. But the fact that they make him totally sovereign in an absolutist sense does not necessarily elevate him to the most admirable status. Because, as I said, there is the flip side of that. There's the dark side of that view, which is that the reason people go to hell is because God wanted them to. Now, again, if God wants to make people for the express purpose of sending them to hell, he's entitled to do it, but he's not the God of the Bible. He's not the God that God said he is in the Bible. Such a concept of God can be entertained without injustice, but it can't be entertained and do justice to Scripture, because the God of Scripture is not willing that any should perish. He rather that all men would repent. He is sad at the loss of any human soul, as the Bible declares. And so this I take to be one of the issues at stake here. What kind of a God governs the universe? What kind of a God do we worship? And, you know, the God of the Calvinists certainly gives us grounds for fear and respect. Any sovereign that powerful and that mighty and that involved and that arbitrary certainly is something to be feared and in awe of. But loved, that's a little harder. We love more readily those things and persons that are lovely. And a God who has ordained that many millions should live just so that they could die and go to hell, and he had no better purpose for them than that, maybe a God to be feared, but not easily one to be loved. And if those who do love him may love him only because of their fear, or because they're selfish enough to delight in the fact that they count themselves to be among those that he pleasantly chose to be saved, but they don't care a great deal. They don't have any biblical grounds for sympathy for those that end up in hell. So, frankly, God wants to be feared and loved, and I believe that his nature is such that if correctly understood, he can be feared and loved. On page 16 of the notes I've given you, I have a little poem here called The Minister's Daughter from John Greenleaf Whittier. It's about a little girl and her father who is a Presbyterian or a Calvinist minister, and she had just heard him preach a sermon about predestination, how God predestined some to be good and some to be evil, and God predestined that man would sin and all this other stuff, and that man would fall in the garden. And here's how the poem goes. I think it's very profound. It says, "Then up spoke the little maiden, treading on snow in pink," out in the garden where the snow was. "Oh, Father, these pretty blossoms are very wicked, I think. had there been no Garden of Eden, there never had been a fall. And if never a tree had blossomed, God would have loved us all. Says the little girl, responding to what seems like the reasonable upshot of the Calvinist theology. And her father rebukes her. "Hush, child," the father answered. "By his decree man fell. His ways are in clouds and darkness, but he doeth all things well. And whether by his ordaining to us cometh good or ill, joy or pain or light or shadow, we must fear and love him still." "Oh, I fear him," said the daughter, "and I try to love him too, but I wish he was as good and gentle, kind and loving as you." This is so profound. I don't know if it hits you the way it hits me. What this is saying is the God of the Calvinist is not even as good as the Calvinist himself. Because the Calvinist does not bring children into being with an intention of destroying them. Jesus said, "Even you fathers being evil know how to give good gifts to your children." But he didn't say, but God doesn't do that to all of his creation. He says, no, but how much more shall your heavenly Father give good things to those who ask him? Jesus indicated that God is more merciful, more gracious, more loving to those that he has brought into existence than an earthly father, even an evil earthly father, is. But the Calvinist theology makes God out to be less kind, less generous, less eager to save and to benefit all that he can than even, a philanthropic heathen. It is this very nature of the God of Calvinism that offends not only Christians but non-Christians alike, because non-Christians themselves care more in many cases for the lost, for the plight of the starving and the disenfranchised. Many non-Christians care more about those people than the Calvinist God does. Because the Calvinist God could save, but doesn't. It's been pointed out that the God of Calvinism, if we would take an illustration from the Good Samaritan parable, the God of Calvinism is more like the Levite and the priest who saw a man in need and passed by than he is like the Samaritan. Because he sees people dying and in need, sinners all the time, beaten up by sin and by the devil and left in a helpless state, but he passes by many when he could have helped them. I have a good quote of some sort on that, it seems to me, here. I don't remember where it is in here, but yeah, I can't find it instantly, so I won't belabor it too much. But the God that we have here, let me see here. Yeah, here it is. It's on page 14 of the notes I gave you, on the page about double predestination. The Calvinist doctrine is that God predestined some to be elect, but in the same act of his good pleasure and lofty sovereign purpose, he predestined that some should be born to go to hell, just because it pleased him to do so, according to Calvin, according to the logical conclusions that one must come to if they accept any of Calvin's points. And Robert Schenck, in a wonderful book called Elect in the Sun, which got him kicked out of the Baptist denomination where he was a preacher because it was not a Calvinist book. On page 193, Robert Schenck said this, "But we must protest that a God who, while rescuing some, simply passes by others in the same lost circumstance, is so little like the good Samaritan in our Lord's parable, and so much like the priest and the Levite, that he cannot be the God who desires all men, who desires to have all men saved and none to perish. Such a God constitutes a total contradiction to the spirit of the words of James, 'To him who knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin.'" James 4:17. "A God so heartless and so arbitrary cannot be the God who so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to exile, sorrow, suffering, and shame and death. He cannot be the God who cries with sorrowing heart and infinite compassion, 'Look to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none other.'" Isaiah 45:22. "He cannot be the God whose grace has appeared for the salvation of all men." Titus 2:11. "Such an arbitrary God is not the God we worship and adore, the God in whom we trust." I think that's a pretty powerful statement, and it's absolutely true. I don't see how anyone could argue against it. The God who has power to save all, but chooses only to save some and leave the others who are in the same misery, in the same helplessness, and leaves them without aid, though he had plenty of aid to give, he's not like the Good Samaritan. He's like those who refuse to help the man at the side of the road. Why? Well, the Calvinists say, no. He's more like the Good Samaritan if the man at the side of the road is one of the elect. Yeah, but the story of the Good Samaritan was that the Samaritan was not one of the friends of the Jew who helped him. That was the Samaritan was the helper, the Jew was the hurting man. These people were not friends by nature. These were people by nature enemies. We do not have here a picture of a man stopping to help his friend. In fact, that's the whole point. Jesus told the story because he said you must love your neighbor as you love yourself, and his critics said, who's my neighbor then? And Jesus gave this story to show that everyone's your neighbor. If everyone in need is your neighbor, therefore you must love every man. And Calvinism suggests that God commands us to love all men and to want them saved, but God himself doesn't love all men. We are commanded to be more loving than God, more universal in our generosity than God. We are to love those that God hates by this view, because God hates sinners and doesn't want them saved. Makes it very difficult to find motivations for evangelism, although we are commanded to do it, and we should, even if Calvinism is true, we should obey God, but it's very hard to find incentive when, in fact, the person that we feel so much compassion for might, for all we know, be one that God hates and has no love for, has no interest in. How can we, with any degree of confidence, persuade that person that God loves him and would want him saved? Maybe we're dealing with a person, and we never know until they persevere to the end and die saved. We never know if the person we're looking at is someone who God loves. You know, Jay Adams, who wrote the book Competent to Counsel and many other good books on counseling, apart from being a good writer on counseling, is a five-point Calvinist, and very strongly so, adamantly so. And one of the things that I would have to take issue with him on in his book Competent to Counsel, a book which in general I recommend heartily, is that he says when you're counseling a person, you should never tell them that Jesus died for them. Because we don't know if the person you're counseling is one of the elect or not. And if they are not of the elect, it would be untrue to tell them that Christ died for them. Now, this is where Calvinism brings you. J. Adams is 100% correct, if Calvinism is correct. You could never tell anyone with certainty, God loves you. Jesus died for you. God has a wonderful plan for your life. God wants you to share eternity with him. God wants you to repent. Because in fact, if God wanted to, God would simply make sure it happened. And the person you witness to might turn out to be one of those people that God doesn't make it happen to. One of those people who doesn't repent or doesn't persevere. Therefore, they turn out to, in fact, not be of the elect. And that gives the lie to all the promises and all the good things you said about God's intention toward them. You could never say those things with conviction if you're really a Calvinist. All you could say is, if you happen to be lucky enough to be one of the elect, then Jesus died for you. Of course, I can't tell you whether you're one of the elect or not. In fact, you can't even know for sure right now if you're one of the elect. So neither you nor I can know whether Jesus died for you or not. But maybe he did, and there's a chance of it. Maybe you could try it out and see if it works. And if it works, then you're one of the elect. And this just is not the way the gospel is presented in Scripture. It is not presented to us in the epistles that way, or in Christ's teaching that way, nor is it ever preached that way in the book of Acts. That is simply not the gospel of Scripture. And yet it is, of necessity, the gospel of Calvinism. There's no way to believe in Calvinism without coming to that conclusion. Yes, you could say we must evangelize because we're commanded to, but what can we say? What is our message? What can we say to the unbeliever who has not yet demonstrated himself to be elect? Can we make any promises of any kind? I don't see how anyone could. There is a statement of Clark Pinnock, not a loved man in the Calvinist camp, and some Arminians want to distance themselves from him too, but I like him, frankly. I don't agree with everything he says, but I believe he says some very profound things which the evangelical community is made uncomfortable by. But on page 21 of the notes I've given you, on the non-Calvinist column, there are two quotes. The second one is by Clark Pinnock, comes from the book Grace Unlimited, which he edited and wrote some of. In that place, on in page 11, Pinnock wrote, "We consent to Paul's judgment that God desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth, and to Peter's conviction that God is not wishing that any should perish, but that all should come to should reach repentance. If it seems controversial to assert this conviction boldly and unashamedly, then it ought at least to be admitted that here is a truth far more deserving of controversy than many which are debated. On it hangs, we believe, the validity of the universal offer of the gospel and the possibility of Christian assurance." We'll talk about that in a moment. "If we do not know that God loves all sinners, we do not know that God loves us. And we do not know that he loves those to whom we take the gospel." Can anyone find a fault in this seamless reasoning? If we don't know that God loves all sinners, then we have no way of being sure that he loves us, because we too are sinners. And we have no way of knowing that he loves the people that we're preaching to. Does that not emasculate the evangelist? Doesn't that cut his hands off and his tongue out and say, "Sorry, you must evangelize, but you can't offer anything with any assurance to anyone. You can just hold out possibilities, potentialities, and then, of course, if the person is really elect, then it'll happen with them." Well, but what will happen, and in response to what message? That's the question. What is the message? Well, the message of Calvinism is not logically consistent with the message as preached and exhibited and explained in Scripture, as I understand it, and it is quite true. Now, some are going to object. A Calvinist would object, of course, to him saying that if we don't know that God loves all sinners, we can't know that he loves us. And yet the Calvinists say, well, sure, we can know that he loves us because we're the elect. Calvinism doesn't teach that God loves no one. Calvinism teaches that God loves the elect. He loves his sons, his children, those that he has chosen to be adopted in his family. He loves them. And we know that we are them. But the next question that the Calvinists must deal with, and they can never do so very well without making a few skips in logic and reasoning, how do we know we are them? How do I know I am elect? Now, you know what? I've sometimes asked Calvinists why they are so adamant to make me into a Calvinist. I don't spend very much effort, or I don't have much incentive to turn them into an Arminian. I don't care if a man's a Calvinist. Some of my very favorite authors who lived a godly life and are going to be higher than I am in heaven, they were Calvinists. I do not think Calvinism is going to damn a man as long as he doesn't live consistently with it. The fact that Calvinists can be good Christians is only true because people are inconsistent creatures. They can believe one thing or profess to believe one thing and actually do another thing. Calvinists all act like Arminians in some areas because they do pray as if something could change. They do make decisions. They do preach the gospel. They do believe they must persevere, and they do act as if they have free choice. But in the back of their minds, they don't believe that any of those things are true because they don't have a real free choice, and they don't really change anything by prayer. It's all been determined. But they can act like Arminians. A.W. Tozer, who was an Arminian, I mean, A.W. Tozer was not a Calvinist. When he was asked whether he was Calvinist or Arminian, he said, "Well, I'm a Calvinist when I pray, and I'm an Arminian when I preach." And that's really how an awful lot of Calvinists are too, or a lot of Christians in general. You pray as if everything was up to God. That's sort of a Calvinist inclination. But you preach as if everything is up to your hearer. He has to respond. That's an Arminian kind of a inclination. And insofar as most Calvinists who are true Christians end up acting like Arminians anyway, and talking like Arminians, unless they're talking about the 5 points specifically, they say all other things the same way Arminians do, unless they're trying to defend this particular structure and paradigm. Of course, Calvinists can be very good Christians, and most of them that I've known have been, and certainly some of the very best Christians I've known have been Calvinists. So I have no campaign to turn Calvinists into Arminians. The only reason I'm even teaching on it now, and I didn't for years, is because there's such a move on the Calvinist side to turn everyone into Calvinists these days. I mean, it's a fairly fresh and new thrust. And I'm only speaking up because I think that thrust could succeed if there's not a voice of biblical reason brought into the debate. And I'm trying to do my best to be as close to that ideal as possible. But I've asked Calvinist friends, why is it so important to you that I be a Calvinist? I mean, what does it really affect? Am I not already living the way you believe a Christian should live? I am. What would change in my life? Well, they said, well, they always say this. They say Calvinism brings more glory to God because it describes a higher degree of sovereignty. We've already discussed that. But the other point is always this. It gives a basis for assurance of salvation because it believes in the perseverance of the saints, that if you're one of the elect, you will never fall away. And if you don't have this doctrine, how could you be sure that you will die saved? If it is possible for the elect to fall away, then maybe you will fall away. You could have no assurance without the Calvinist doctrine. You could have no assurance that you will die saved and end up in heaven after all. But my response is, maybe it is so that by not being a Calvinist, I could not be sure whether I will die saved. But by being a Calvinist, I could not be sure that I am saved now. And this is a fact. And here's how I reason. And there's no arguing against this. And Calvinists have sputtered and never been able to answer effectively because there is, to my mind, no answer to this fact. If indeed the only way that a person proves himself to be elect is by enduring to the end. And this is, of course, the case because it's not a matter of feeling good about God right now or living a holy life now. That's not it, because a lot of people have done that before and fallen away. Fortunately, not as many as could be imagined, but there have been some. I've known some. Some of you have known some. I know people who were zealously evangelistic, rejoicing in the Lord, delivered from sin and drugs in their life and serving God for years, backslid, went back into drugs, died of an overdose. One man in particular who led many people to the Lord, loved God, died of AIDS because of sins that he fell back into. These people had such evidences of true salvation in their lives, both in their hearts, in which they greatly rejoiced in salvation and loved God, and their fervency was evident to all. And yet they fell away. What I can say is this. On Calvinist premises, these persons were not saved when they seemed to be, because if they had been, they would have stayed saved. If you fall away, it only shows you never were elect, because the elect never fall away. Now, if that is true, then these people I'm describing who did fall away and died in that state of fallenness, they were not saved earlier, despite all the evidences that they were. Now, I can allow this if such a thing were biblically possible to sustain, which I don't believe it is, but I could allow for this to be true. The only problem is, if it is true, I can't be sure that I'm saved. Because these people whose later history showed that they weren't saved, according to Calvinist views, gave so many evidences of being saved that I'm not sure that I have more evidence than they had that I'm saved. I hate to tell this story because it is so grieving to my own heart. And it destroys a wonderful testimony in a way that I love to appeal to. But some of you heard me tell it before. The man who wrote the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." Many of us have heard the story. Ira Sankey, I think his name was. Maybe it was someone else. I might be thinking of someone else. But the man, I read his story more than once. Part of the story we usually hear is this. The man worked with D.L. Moody as a hymn writer and I think a lesser preacher and so forth. He lived in Chicago. He was a lawyer. He owned a lot of property on the lake shore. And the great fire that destroyed much of Chicago, where Mrs. O'Leary's cow kicked the lantern over in the barn, you know, that great fire took all of his real estate holdings. He was just largely impoverished by that fire, lost great abundance of money and real estate in that. He had other problems, too, about the same time, serious problems, and therefore he decided it was time for his family and he to take a bit of a break. So they were going to take a ship over to England and have a bit of a vacation. But at the last minute, some business came up. He couldn't cancel the family's reservations, but he couldn't go either. So he sent the family on ahead, his wife and his four daughters. The ship that he would have been on, that his wife and four daughters were on, sank. It was hit by another ship, sank within a few minutes. I think within 10 or 15 minutes, it sank. He received a telegram from his wife from England saying, "I was saved alone. His four daughters drowned." A few days later, he took his ship to join his wife in England, and it is, as the story is told, he stood by the rail of the ship at the approximate place the other ship had gone down, where his daughters had perished. And there, contemplating his the death of his four daughters only a few days earlier in that very spot. He wrote the inspiring words, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." I have had that experience myself. I had a wife who died, and God taught me to say, it was well with my soul, and it is. And I've often related with that man. I've often thought, you know, that grace is such a mark of election. That grace is such a mark of really knowing God, really being saved. The problem is this man, in his later years, sadly, went to Israel, proclaimed himself the second Messiah, and suffered in a delusion about himself. Now, we either have to say that the man was mentally incompetent, and he was saved. God saved him anyway, even though he had kind of a flaky close to his life and poor testimony. Or we have to say that he didn't persevere. And in a sense, if a person didn't persevere in a sound mind, became a heretic and so forth, then Calvinist terms, that's defection. That's not perseverance. Now, here's the problem. If this man did not persevere, as Calvinism suggests, he was not elect. That means he was never saved. How does one account for the incredible grace of God upon him to suffer the loss of his entire financial holdings and the loss of four daughters and still give glory to God? Sincerely, it would appear. And to be a close associate with D.L. Moody, and Moody never noticed, the guy's not really saved. I mean, let's face it, the guy gave incredible evidence of really knowing God. But by Calvinist suggestions, he really didn't know God. It was a delusion. Well, then maybe my knowing God is a delusion. Maybe I don't know God. Do I have as much evidence that I'm a real Christian as some of these people who fell away had at one time in their life? How can I know for sure? You see, the theology itself deprives me of any assurance of my salvation. Because the only way I will ever know if I'm saved now, and I can't know it now, I'll only know it if on my deathbed, with my dying breath, I say, it is well with my soul, I'm still saved, I'm going to see Jesus, I've fought the good fight, I've not defected. Now I know I'm saved because I'm going to take my last breath, I won't have time to backslide again. But see, you see, Calvinism doesn't guarantee that people won't backslide. It only says if they did, they never were saved. It doesn't guarantee that people won't backslide. Therefore, it doesn't provide any conviction or any grounds for any person to have conviction that they're saved. Now, I've had Calvinists say, "Oh, you just don't understand what God does that gives me assurance of my election." Well, I think I do. I think I do, and I think that some of these people I've known personally and whose biographies I've heard, I think they knew too exactly what the modern Calvinist means when he says, "I know I'm elect. I know that I know God. I know that I'm born again. I have XYZ evidence. I have this total assurance in my heart." Well, are you saying that these people didn't have those things? I dare say you'd better meet them. Because I have known such people rather closely and intimately, and I dare say they had as much assurance as any modern Calvinist has, every bit as much assurance as I have today. And I have total assurance, by the way, at this moment. I have not one doubt in my mind that I'm saved. You know why? Because the Bible says I'm saved by faith. And you know what? I believe God. What's more, I also believe that it's not a crapshoot whether I'm going to believe God on my deathbed. I can choose that too. I'm by the grace of God. I don't sustain myself by my strength, but the Bible says I'm kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. That is the most significant balance of this concept in the Scripture, and where assurance of salvation hinges. It's 1 Peter 1:5 says, "We are kept, that is, guarded, by the power of God." I don't have to trust in my own strength. It's the power of God that I put my trust in. I know I won't fall away because of the power of God, but I'm kept by the power of God through faith. And everywhere, faith is my responsibility. God gives me incentives for faith. God gives me encouragement in faith. But it is my decision and my responsibility and mine to be blamed if I don't have faith. Faith is what I do. Faith is just believing. And if I will believe God, His power will be an unbroken supply of strength and security for me. I do not experience what anyone could call eternal insecurity because I don't have a moment of insecurity. Not only do I have not eternal insecurity, I don't have so much as a second of insecurity. I am secure. Now, does this mean I don't believe I could fall away? Of course I believe I could fall away. I can't just imagine why I would want to. And if I began to trust, if I began to change my doctrine and think that, well, I need to save myself, I could imagine that God would allow something to happen to me. You know, you begin to trust in yourself. You begin to congratulate yourself. The Bible says, if any man thinks he stands, let him take heed lest he fall. Man, as soon as you start talking about, I'm standing in my own strength, and you take any confidence in it, you're just you're asking God to knock you down. I just read yesterday about the Titanic. You know, everyone knows that the Titanic was this great technological marvel in its day, and it was argued that nothing could sink it. I didn't realize until yesterday I read that the builder of the Titanic, the designer of it, he said, not even God could sink this ship. Well, I'll tell you something. If I was going to take a cruise and I found out that the builder of the ship said, not even God could sink this ship, I'd take a different ship. If anyone thinks he stands, he's asking for it, man. He's just inviting God. Try me. Try to sink this ship, God. I defy you. Well, God takes challenges up. And if you think you can stand on your own, take heed. God may just knock you down and show you you can't. And people do fall away. But I don't think anyone has ever yet fallen away while trusting God. People fall away because they stop trusting God and start trusting themselves and start thinking that they can do it and that they're pretty sanctified by now and they can pretty well pull this off themselves. And if people fall away, that's the mistake they're making, because no one ever falls away while trusting God. We are kept by the power of God through our faith unto salvation. I am secure only because I fully believe that I can never trust in myself. God has graciously broken me of all self-confidence so that I know that I have only hope in Jesus. And I can't imagine ever being persuaded otherwise. If I were to be persuaded otherwise, I do believe I could fall away. But I have no expectation of that whatsoever. I have as much security, more security than a Calvinist has any grounds to have. Because the Calvinist can only say, if I am elect, and I hope I am, and I believe I am, then I will never fall away. However, too many people who believe they were elect did fall away. So the Calvinist must always think in the back of his mind, am I any better than they are? Am I really any more, do I have more grounds to believe I'm elect than that person believed he had? Maybe not. I could, if I'm not elect, then I might fall away, you see. And in which case, it not only tells me that I won't necessarily die saved, I may not be saved at the moment. At least the biblical doctrine, which is the non-Calvinist view, as I understand it, teaches that I can know I'm saved now. I can know that I'll be saved tomorrow, the next day, and forever. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And as long as my trust is in Him, His power will keep me. And I don't ever have to worry about being too weak or being overpowered by temptation so long as I'm looking to Jesus. So long as I set my gaze. That's not a virtuous thing. I don't get some kind of credits or brownie points or gold sticky stars in heaven for looking at Jesus. I do that largely because I'm desperate. It's an act of desperation. But the desperation is what, and the fact that I know myself desperate means I'm going to keep looking. And I will keep receiving grace to help in time of need. And God has proven Himself faithful in my life for over 40 years. And I have no reason to believe that the next 40 or 50 or 60, however few many I have, I don't believe God will change. And therefore, I fully expect to spend all eternity in heaven, and I have as much assurance as a human being can have with any theology. It seems to me I have more assurance than a Calvinist is entitled to have, because the Bible tells me, if you do well, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do well, sin lieth at the door, and it seeks to have you. In other words, the ball's in your court. I'm so glad in the sense that it is. Not because I'd rather be in my own hands than God's hands, but if I were in the hands of a God who prefers to send some people to hell, basically because that's His preference, at least God has said, I'll let you decide. If I believe that God was the one making the decision, that might make me love God a great deal so long as I had serious reason to believe I was elect. But a realistic person has to realize that the only proof that one is elect is that they die saved. And since I haven't died yet, I could never really, on logical Calvinist grounds, I could never know that I'm saved now. At least the Bible tells me I can know and decide if I'll be with Jesus now, tomorrow, the next day, and so forth. Not by my own strength, by His power, but by my faith, by my trusting, by my gaze, by looking unto Jesus, which a child can do. It doesn't take strength, it doesn't take virtue, it just takes desperation. And that is the grounds of my assurance. I do not know how a person with the contrary theology could have assurance, except by personal self-delusion, and say, whatever anyone else experienced, it couldn't have been like what I'm experiencing. Those people who fell away, although they seemed to be wonderful Christians, they couldn't have been as wonderful a Christian as I believe myself to be, because my wonderful Christianity is what proves to me I'm elect. But, you know, if there is one flaw in the character, maybe that's a like flaw to that which caused that person to look away from God and fall away. Now, fortunately, no matter how many flaws I have in my character, I'm not looking to these signs of my election to prove that I'm elect. I am looking to these signs. The one sign I'm looking to is that I'm still trusting Jesus. I'm still trusting God. And that's the only thing the Bible really says will save me and keep me. But that's enough. Okay, let's now look at the third page. How do we reach conclusions from Scripture? How do we reason from the Scripture? Now, we're not talking about trusting in your own understanding. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, Proverbs 3:5. And when we talk about reasoning from Scripture, we're not talking about leaning on your own understanding. We're talking about how to know what God said so we can trust in Him. There is no grounds for being anti-rational or anti-intellectual. There's a tremendous sector of the church that is officially and unashamedly anti-intellectual. And that is as if one would say, God's given me a wonderful voice, but I'll never sing because I think it's evil. God gave you a wonderful mind, but for you to not use it because it seems evil, it seems carnal to use this tool. You know, if God says build a house, and among your tools you're going to need a saw, a hammer, and whatever, a few other things, a plane and so forth. And you say, okay, I'll use all the tools, but not the saw, because I think that's an evil thing. I've seen people use saws in a very evil way. In fact, wasn't Isaiah the prophet sawn in two? There's an evil use of a saw. We better never use this saw. And so you're supposed to build a house, and God gave you all these tools. You say, but this tool I will not use. I have decided this tool is corrupt. This tool is evil. When in fact the same tool was invented by God and given to you so that you might use it for His glory, that you could love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And therefore, to reason, which is a privilege given to human beings but not to animals, which is an aspect of the nature of God that is not given to any other creatures on the planet except for man and woman, to take this tool and say, I'm sorry, I think it's corrupt, we won't use it, is to avoid being able to accomplish what God wanted you to accomplish, among other things, knowing what's true. It's one of the things God wants you to accomplish, and He gave you a mind for that. It's not the only tool. You've got the Spirit for discernment. You've got the Bible to sort out and to make judgments between true and false. But your mind is one of the tools, and to throw that tool out is going to greatly cripple you and make it impossible for you to really do what needs to be done. So how is the mind to be used? Well, first of all, it's to be submitted to Scripture. But the submission of the mind to Scripture means that the mind uses the Scripture properly. The law is good if it's used lawfully, and the Scripture is useful only if it's used scripturally. And what you think about the Scripture will only be correct if you think properly about it. Well, let me give you some rules that almost everyone will agree with, although I want to apply these rules to the present controversy between the Calvinist construct and the non-Calvinist. First of all, the Scripture is the final authority for the Christian. Regardless how firmly entrenched a tradition may be, or how respected or heroic are its historical advocates, the direct testimony of Scripture overrules all contrary testimony and opinion. Even if the contrary opinion comes from an angel from heaven, Paul said in Galatians 1:8, if we are an angel from heaven, preached to you some other gospel than that which was preached, let him be accursed. I don't care if it was John Calvin. I don't care if it was Spurgeon, one of my great heroes. I don't care if it was the Puritan writers who were Calvinists. It doesn't matter. If it was an angel from heaven, if it's different than what the Bible says, then it simply is not to be followed. It doesn't mean that the men who taught these things were bad men. They may have been wonderful men. But wonderful men can be mistaken too. And in deciding what is true, we don't just let some human being or angel, for that matter, decide for us. We must allow the Scripture to decide. I quoted earlier in this series a quote from John Owen in his book, A Display of Arminianism, who said, who would have thought that our church, meaning the Presbyterian church, would ever have, or maybe he was congregational, I forget, would ever have given entertainment to these Belgic semi-Pelagians, he means Arminians, who have cast dirt upon the faces and raked up the ashes of all those great and pious souls whom God magnified in using as instruments to reform his church, to the least of which the whole troop of Arminians shall never make themselves equal, though they swell till they break. You know, as you can puff yourself up as much as you want in your own opinion, you Arminians, and by the way, Arminians always do that, of course. They are very proud because they believe that they can save themselves, according to Calvinist mischaracterizations. But let those Arminians swell and think highly of themselves, they will. The whole troop of Arminians will never be equal to the least of these great reformers. Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, Beza, and the rest, Melanchthon. And these men, why, these Arminians, they cast dirt in the faces of these men. These great and pious men that God used to reform his church. Well, let me tell you something. As far as I know, every Arminian praises God for those men. I do. I certainly praise God for Luther. I praise God for Calvin. And I also praise God for a lot of people who disagreed with them. But I believe that God used imperfect men, men who know in part. I believe that God uses men who are available, or even men whom God recruits, who were not previously that available, but that he can use whoever he will, and I can thank God for them. I can even have a high opinion of them. I don't necessarily have a high opinion of all those men, but I could, and it would not mean I have to believe what they say. And this is the point first. The Scripture, regardless how firmly entrenched a tradition may be, or how respected or heroic its historical advocates were, that tradition cannot be allowed to overrule the direct testimony of Scripture. Now, of course, the Calvinists would say, we don't do that. We don't overrule testimony of Scripture. We're saying only what the Scripture says. Well, okay, they can say that if they wish. But the Arminian believes that about himself, too. The difference is that the Arminian doesn't invoke heroes. He taught this, and how dare we go away from the famous Augustine and his great teachings, or the noble Calvin and his wonderful teachings. Arminians don't say, now listen, Arminius said this, and therefore it is so. Every Arminian I've met said, the Bible says this, and what do you do with that? You know, I mean, I don't care what Calvin said, I don't care what Augustine said, I don't care what Luther said. I want to know, what do you do with the Scriptures when it plainly says this, and it says it again and again and again in every kind of situation, where the context itself does not alter its plain meaning but supports it? What do you do with that? That is, in fact, what, in my understanding, always happens in these debates. But, lest you think that I'm characterizing the Calvinist as one who doesn't quote Scripture, I want to make it clear. Every Calvinist I've ever debated quoted a great deal of Scripture. But in my opinion, of course, he was using the Scriptures wrongly. And that's why once we've decided that the Scripture is the authority, we need to decide how do we figure out what the Scripture means. And therefore, number two, a rule for reasoning from Scripture, rule number two, where two opposite opinions appear to find support from Scripture, those on one side of the debate or the other must be misinterpreting the passages that seem to support their position. Obviously, two positions that are mutually exclusive cannot be both supported in Scripture unless the Scripture contradicts itself, which it does not. Rule number three, a passage that can be used for the support of both sides cannot add strength to either side of the dispute. Thus, if a proof text for one position is as easily and naturally accommodated by the opposite system as well, it is of no value in settling the question under discussion. Now, do you know what I mean by that? What I mean is that a Calvinist will say, my view of election is true because it says in the Scripture, whom God foreknew, He also predestinated. And it says also that we are elect in Christ before the foundation of the world. Well, the Arminian says, well, we love those Scriptures too. In fact, we have no problem understanding those Scriptures in the paradigm of our framework of theology. Now, does this mean the Arminian wins the argument? No. But it certainly doesn't mean the Calvinist does. No one wins the argument. If the only Scriptures that can be produced fit equally well into either paradigm, we're going to come to a draw unless there comes some Scriptures into the debate that don't fit into both paradigms equally well. You see? And there are some that don't fit both paradigms equally well without doing tremendous violence to them. And therefore, the debate must be settled not on the grounds of who can quote the most Scriptures, but who has the Scriptures on their side which cannot be fit into the other side. Because in debates with Calvinists, it seems like Calvinists sometimes rattle off 10 Scriptures in 30 seconds, you know, I mean, or phrases, you know. How can he who is dead in sins, who the thoughts of the imagination of his heart is only in evil continually, whose heart is desperately wicked, and who can know it, and who, you know, is wise to do evil but cannot do good, how can such a person be saved on his own? You know, I mean, in that very statement, there's four different Scriptures mentioned in 10 seconds. And this commonly happens in the debates I've heard. The Calvinist rattles off scriptural phrases here and there in the other place. The only thing is, none of those statements and none of the Scriptures they're found in are any problem to the Arminian. You may get the impression the Calvinist, his position is bolstered by an incredibly large amount of Scripture. Well, the problem is that if every one of those Scriptures the Arminian can bring up to and say, well, let's look at that passage in its context. The people before the flood are described as the thoughts and every imagination of their heart was only evil continually. Okay, is this universal of all people? Well, it's describing society generally before the flood. Was Noah an exception? Yes. Well, then maybe Noah was an exception, then there must be exceptions. When Paul quotes David in Romans 3 and says there's none good, no, not one, there's none that seeks God, was not David who wrote that himself an exception? Wasn't he seeking God? He said he was. Why should we believe him when he says no one seeks God and not believe him when he says he seeks God? It seems clear that if you look at the Scriptures in context, you'll find that these statements do not say what the Calvinist wants them to say. And they fit just as nicely in the Arminian construct. Now, it doesn't mean the Arminians have the better interpretation of them than the Calvinists do. It simply means that those particular Scriptures add nothing to the conclusion that we're seeking. You have to have Scriptures that don't fit into both sides equally well before you can make any headway and decide which view is more scriptural. You understand that that's true? I'm just trying to make that clear. Okay. Fourth point. It is thus instructive to pay close and critical attention not only to a debater's explanation of those Scriptures that appear to establish his cause, but more especially his ability to soundly expound upon those which appear to contradict his position. Now, obviously, if Calvinists and Arminians can both sustain an argument from Scripture, there must be some Scriptures that appear to support Calvinism and some that appear to support Arminianism. It's not surprising that a Calvinist can get up there and quote all the Scriptures that sound Calvinistic and say, there you are. Or that an Arminian can get up and quote all the Scriptures that sound Arminian and say, well, there you have it. The question is, what does the Arminian do to exposit on the Scriptures that the Calvinist quotes? And what does the Calvinist do with those Scriptures that the Arminian quotes? If you would like to know, in this particular case, the answer to that question, I'd recommend that you get, for example, one of the great books supporting Calvinism by one of the great Calvinist authors, whether it's Calvin himself or whether it is some of the Puritan writers. Not many of them wrote books defending Calvinism per se, but they all came from a Calvinist perspective. But the ones that really sought to deal with the Arminian proof texts, the Calvinists that did that were principally that I know of, John Owen in his book, A Display of Arminianism, and Christopher Ness in his book, An Antidote Against Arminianism. These men specifically tried to address the issues that the Arminians brought up, the scriptures that are used to support Arminianism, these Calvinists tried to explain those scriptures. If you get those books, and they're short ones, they basically will tell you how well Calvinists can answer these Arminian texts. If you want to check the other side out, I'd recommend that you take any good Arminian book, but one that I think is just marvelous is Robert Shank's book, Life in the Son. Life in the Son is about the doctrine of perseverance, but it ends up dealing with most of the Calvinist points in prospect, and it deals with virtually every major Calvinist proof text, and basically expounds them. Now, I'll tell you this. I was not born an Arminian, nor was I born a Calvinist, but I was raised a Baptist, and although I didn't know what all the points of Calvinism were, I was largely disposed toward Calvinism, as I understood it. I did not make it my goal to debunk Calvinism or to become something other than a Calvinist. And as I said earlier, I once identified as a Calvinist in a debate against a Pelagian. I mean, I have, you know, I'm not a person who's got an agenda out to destroy Calvinism or has looked for every reason to reject it. I can remember making Calvinists very upset with me, and Arminians too, when they'd say, what do you believe about eternal security? I'd say, well, I don't think about it much. I mean, if I'm reading Romans, I kind of lean Calvinistic. If I read Hebrews, I kind of lean Arminian. And I just didn't care to settle it. I had no axe to grind. And I even now, believe it or not, don't have an axe to grind. I'm just trying to dull an axe that's been hurled from the other side, you know. But the fact is that when I have read how the Calvinists address the so-called Arminian proof text, and I've read how the Arminians address the so-called Calvinist proof text, there's no contest. There's absolutely no contest. The Arminian writers have no difficulty whatsoever accommodating every scripture that a Calvinist brings. He doesn't have to. Arminians don't have to resort to contortions and twisting and importing words that aren't there and so forth. The Arminian theology, or at least some form of non-Calvinistic theology, is entirely capable of embracing the whole counsel of Scripture, not only those that are plainly Arminian in their sound, but even those that the Calvinists like to use. They fit very nicely. All you have to do is shift the paradigm a little bit over to a little more non-Calvinistic way, and everything fits very nicely. I can't show you this in completion right now, although what I will do in our next two classes, I'm going to be taking some of the major arguments and major scriptures of the Calvinists and talk about them from the perspective that I believe is biblical, and you'll have at least a sampling of what I'm talking about. But you can get a book like Life in the Son by Robert Shank, and he leaves no stone unturned. I mean, he takes them all. And you'll never find some unnaturalness, some twistedness, some desperation of exegesis in a intelligent Arminian approach to the Calvinist texts. But I have yet to find a single Calvinist writer who can handle the Arminian sounding text without resorting to, you know, fathomless mysteries and contradictions we just have to accept because it's biblical, and import the word elect here in about 40,000 verses where it isn't found, because only by importing the word elect do you get a Calvinist reading of this verse. I mean, the twisting and contortions are astonishing. And I say this again as one who is not particularly one who set himself to destroy Calvinism. I don't care if a person's a Calvinist. I'm simply speaking as an objective viewer looking at the evidence. If you ask which side of this debate can more readily and naturally accommodate the scriptures of his opponent into his own theology, just read it. Just consult them. There'll be no question. I don't have to tell you the answer. It's obvious. The Calvinist has to twist, contort, import, eisegete right and left. He's got his several handfuls of texts that sound Calvinistic to him. And as he imposes a certain paradigm, they fit well into a distinctively Calvinistic viewpoint. But what the Calvinist has seldom done is figure, is it possible that all the scriptures in the Bible, not just these ones, but all the scriptures in the Bible could fit a single paradigm? If so, it's not going to be a Calvinist one. And that is demonstrated by the desperate attempts of Calvinist writers to try to explain why these Arminian-sounding texts aren't really Arminian in their meaning. It's almost funny if people didn't take it so seriously. I mean, it's a funny thing to read. You think, this man graduated from college? This man is a minister? He's called a theologian? This man says he honors the scripture, but he imposes this meaning on a text which is not in any way suggested in the scripture. It's only suggested by the demands of his theology. This is a man who says that his movement embraces a principle of sola scriptura. This is astonishing. And I dare say you should do the research for yourself. Of course, I probably have done you a disservice by telling you my conclusions, but I give you credit for being thinking people. I don't think Calvin has to think for you, and I don't think I have to think for you. I think you can look at it yourself, and you are given a rational mind by God. I think you can see where the evidence leads. Fifth thing, some basic rules of interpretation must be observed in handling Scripture. This is not just with reference to debated points, but this is just a matter of understanding Scripture correctly. First, the words of the original languages, Greek and Hebrew, must be accurately translated. The degree of accuracy doesn't always affect a crucial point, but sometimes it does. Many times a very important point rests on the meaning of a Greek word. The debate over Acts 13:48 rests on the meaning of a Greek word. It says all... Well, it doesn't entirely, but in one sense, it's affected by it. It says all those who are ordained to eternal life believed, or those who are appointed to eternal life believed. Some Greek scholars say that that Greek word means all those who were disposed to eternal life. But it doesn't say who disposed them, whether they disposed themselves. The previous verse says all those who rejected it had judged themselves unworthy of eternal life. But those who are disposed to eternal life believed. It does, but the Calvinist believes that the only possible meaning is ordained or appointed in a sense that by someone else, by God. Now, even if this were true, it fits well enough into the Calvinist or the Arminian view as well. We're going to talk about that next time. But a Greek or Hebrew word may decide the question, and a mistranslated word can be very misleading. The meaning of a statement must be understood by consideration of both its micro and its macro context. That would be the immediate context of the passage it's in, as well as the macro context of everything the Bible says on a given subject. You've got to understand every verse in connection with the whole counsel of God, both in the immediate passage and in the whole of Scripture. The meaning of a passage of Scripture cannot contradict the properly understood meaning of another passage of Scripture. The best interpretation is that which most naturally accommodates all of the biblical data. If you've got one verse, and it could mean this, that, or the other thing, you've got choice A, B, or C, but only choice B accommodates all the rest of Scripture, choices A and C would kind of run into conflict with the rest of the teaching of Scripture, then you've got to choose point B, because that's the only one that harmonizes. And final point on this issue, obscure statements in the Scripture should be interpreted in the light of plain statements in the same. Okay? In other words, if Jesus said he died for his sheep, he laid down his life for his sheep, this does not affirm necessarily he died for no one else. It could mean that or it could not. It's ambiguous. He could be saying he died only for his sheep, but he could also just be saying he died for his sheep as well as for others. The only way to know, to settle the obscurity, is to go to a plain text where it says he died for all men. He, not for us only, but also for the whole world. He took away the sins of the world. He tasted death for every man. These are fairly plain statements, and they help to decide the interpretation of the more obscure statement. Sixth rule for reasoning. In reasoning from the Scripture, as in all reasoning, one's position is weakened when one misrepresents the opposite position, giving the impression that the actual position of the opponent cannot be refuted until it has been substituted with a caricature of itself. Arguments are also weakened by resorting to logical fallacies, and there are several logical fallacies mentioned there. Misrepresenting your opponent's position definitely weakens your argument, as I said, because one wonders, well, could you have beat this argument if you didn't misrepresent it? Maybe in its real form you couldn't beat it, so you had to twist it to make some caricature, some monstrosity of it so that you could find fault with it. I have attempted and it's been more important to me than it apparently is to some, to not misrepresent the Calvinist teaching. Now, I'm sure that some Calvinists who would hear these tapes might say, well, you sure didn't get me right there. I don't believe it that way. That's not what I think. But I have done my best to represent fairly the Calvinists that I have read and who have spoken to me. It's not my fault if there are some Calvinists who think some things a little differently, to have a little different slant on it. I'm representing what Calvin said, as best I know how. I'm representing what leading Calvinists mostly say. And, of course, accepting the first premise of Calvinism, what good Calvinists must say, unless they're going to become inconsistent to their own system. So I'm not saying I'm perfectly representing them, because I'm a flawed individual and may be flawed in my representation, but I believe that I am representing the Calvinist view as a Calvinist would represent it also. This is not always done when Calvinists try to represent the Arminian. And the reason is not so much that Calvinists are mean-spirited and they just don't care about misrepresenting someone to criticize them. I think it is that very few Calvinists have ever read Arminians with an open mind. Those who do sometimes don't remain Calvinists. But I think that an Arminian has no choice but to read Calvinists, because there are so many of the books, so many of the commentaries, so many of the classic literature is written by good Calvinist Christian men. Therefore, the Arminian doesn't have the option of thinking poorly of Calvinists. He doesn't have the option of being mean-spirited toward them. Many of his heroes are Calvinists, even if he disagrees with them. It's sort of like a Christian can't be anti-Semitic because our hero is a Jew. And I don't see how any Arminian could very well be anti-Calvinist in the sense of hating or disliking Calvinists per se, because too many wonderful people that we admire are Calvinists. No question about it. Well, I'm not sure if there's very many Arminians that any Calvinist admires, because Arminians are ipso facto declared to be heretics by that theology. Even someone wonderful like Wesley, I don't know how many Arminians or how many Calvinists are willing to say good things about Wesley. They certainly don't have anything good to say about Finney in general. And so I think that the charity issue is more likely to be on the side of the Arminian toward the Calvinist than vice versa. I already quoted you how John Owen felt about Calvinists. Christopher Ness didn't feel very good about Calvinists either. But what's the attitude of the Arminian? Well, according to J.K. Grider, in a book, Evangelical Dictionary of Theology, under the article on Arminianism, he said, Arminianism is the theological stance of James Arminius, sometimes called the Quiet Dutchman, and the movement that stemmed from him. It views Christian doctrine much as the pre-Augustinian fathers did, and as did the later John Wesley. It is an important aspect of Arminian tradition, from Arminius himself, through Wesley, to present to the present, to be of a tolerant spirit, unquote. I didn't realize this, but I can see that it's true, that it's an important aspect of the Arminian tradition, from Arminius himself through John Wesley into the present, to be of a tolerant spirit. I have never heard an Arminian speak with hostility and hatred toward Calvinists per se. I mean, I can be adamant in saying how strongly I disagree. That's not the same thing as being hostile toward the system. I'm pretty upset by false statements that are made irresponsibly, no matter who makes them. And some Calvinists have made some irresponsible statements. Perhaps some Arminians have too, and I wouldn't care for those statements. But the fact is, I've never met an Arminian who's made it his goal to turn everyone into Arminians. But I certainly have met a lot of Calvinists who's it's almost like the Great Commission is go into all the world and make Calvinists of all nations. You know, I mean, that's almost how they read it. And there is not a tolerant spirit as often on that side. Now, I only say that in order to point out that misrepresentation of Calvinism is not done as often by the Arminian as the misrepresentation of Arminianism is done by Calvinists. Because I don't think the Arminians are motivated by a blind hatred for that system. that they are refuting. And therefore, they're not motivated to play fast and loose with the facts about their opponents. And perhaps the same could be said about many Calvinists, but some Calvinists, certainly, they are determined to destroy that heresy from the pit of hell, as they call it, Arminianism. And they are so adamant that they really, many times, have to misrepresent it in order to make it sound bad. There's nothing particularly bad or unscriptural about what non-Calvinist theologians say, but to make it sound bad, some Calvinists are eager, or else just not careful enough to even read it with an open mind, to not understand it or not represent it correctly. This weakens their position, it seems to me. There are other logical fallacies that weaken a person's argument. One's called petitio principii, I guess. I don't speak Latin. But it means begging the question or circular reasoning. Begging the question means you take as a given, a starting point in your argument, a premise that is actually the point under dispute. You know? An example of this is when the men who wrote the book Calvinism, Hyper-Calvinism and Arminianism say, how could... let me see this quote here. This quote I find at the top of page 9 of your notes. They say... Oh, no, that's not the right quote. That's a misrepresentation. Yeah, okay. There's another quote by these same men. They say, how could the... immutable decrees of the sovereign God be changed by... You know what I'm talking about? Here it is. No, that's not it. Remember that quote? I thought it was there, but that's a different quote by the same guys. There is a quote by them I have, but if I can't find it now, I can't find it. They basically say that, you know, they argue that Arminianism can't be true because it would be necessary then for finite man to be able to change the sovereignly unchangeable decrees of God. Now that is begging the question, because one of the questions under dispute is whether there are sovereign, indisputable decrees of God about man's individual salvation. That is the very point at question. And yet they use that as a starting point for their argument. Since there are these immutable, sovereign, unchangeable decrees of God, therefore Arminianism must be wrong because it would be necessary to believe that man could change them. Page 5, is it? Thanks. Okay, yeah, the quote is... How could a sovereign deity who has foreordained all things from all eternity have his decrees changed by the wiles of man who is a creature of God and is dependent upon him for his own existence? This is an excellent case of begging the question. Presuming as the starting point for your argument the point that is under dispute. Starting out with the idea that there is a God who has foreordained all things from eternity. Okay, well, that I'm not so sure that he has foreordained all things from eternity. But that's the Calvinist proposition. Now, starting with that, it's clear that Arminianism cannot be true. Well, that's true. If you start with any of the Calvinist points, it's clear that Arminianism can't be true. But why start there? Why not start with something that's established? Why not start with something that all can agree on? There certainly must be something we all agree on, like let's even make it the inspiration of Scripture. Or some other point that we can agree on. But don't start with something that's under dispute and make that the basis for all later arguments. There's also the excluded middle. This is a logical fallacy called the excluded middle, or a false dichotomy. It's where you're given two choices. It's either this or it's that. A good example of that is from the same authors. And this is from page 9. That's the quote I was thinking of. Here's a good example of the fallacy of the excluded middle. Those same authors write this. The matter may be presented in this simple thesis. Either God is the first cause of salvation by his sovereign will, or man is the first cause in salvation by his sovereign will. Okay, there you have it. You got two choices. Either God is the first cause of salvation in his sovereign will, or else man is the first cause of salvation in his sovereign will. Well, I mean, anyone who knows the Bible would have to, if those are the choices, we've got to choose God as the first cause of salvation. But this is a false dichotomy. Those aren't the only two options. Arminianism doesn't say that man is the first cause of his own salvation. God is the first cause of salvation in both systems. The only difference is that man has a vote in Arminianism and he doesn't in the other. There is a middle position that God is not the only cause and man is not the only cause. And man certainly not the first cause, but man might be the last cause. God starts it, but man has to make a decision. And, to suggest these are our choices and we have to choose them, and the one that sounds more Arminian is the ridiculous one, though we must be Calvinist, is called the fallacy of the excluded middle. There is another possibility besides the two that are offered. It's a false dichotomy, naming two extremes and suggesting there's no middle ground. There's, of course, the logical fallacy called the abusive ad hominem argument, which is basically a cheap shot. Basically saying, if I said all Calvinists, have an IQ under 70, or whatever it is. I don't know what the IQ name would be. But, that's not relevant to the point. First of all, it's probably not true. And if it was true, it still wouldn't tell us anything about whether Calvinism is true or not. It's illogical to take an attack of your opponent personally when, in fact, what is under discussion is not him, but his ideas. You need to discuss the truthfulness of his ideas, not his own intelligence or lack thereof or something. And that's called an abusive ad hominem approach. The non sequitur is another logical fallacy. It means does not follow necessarily. So someone says, if this is true, and this is true, then necessarily we have this conclusion. If God is sovereign, then it must be that he foreordains all things. That's what R.C. Sproul said. When we say that God is sovereign, we're only saying that God foreordains all things that are. Wait a minute, does that necessarily follow? Is it not possible for God to be sovereign and yet not foreordain all things? The suggestion is a non sequitur. It does not necessarily follow, but the impression that it does necessarily follow gives the man the illusion of advantage in the debate, but it is really a false advantage. It doesn't really tell you the truth because he's playing fast and loose with logic. He's suggesting that one conclusion follows a premise which doesn't necessarily have to follow that premise. There could be a different conclusion that's also consistent with that premise. There's also the fallacy of a cavalier dismissal. That's where someone hears a good argument against their case and just ignores it or treats it as light and doesn't give it its full weight but moves on to something else. This happens with Jehovah's Witnesses all the time. Cavalier dismissal is their favorite thing. You say, okay, you say Jesus isn't God, but what about this scripture that says it is? And they'll take you somewhere else to talk about something else. You say, but what about this scripture? It says Jesus, the Word was God. No, and they go over to something else. They'll want to get you off on another subject. It's as if you didn't even make a point because they can't handle it. Their view cannot accommodate it. Therefore, they pretend it's not there. They dismiss it in a cavalier manner. R.C. Sproul did that when he was talking about Romans chapter 9 in a quote I gave earlier, where he says, the Arminians say that this Esau and Jacob choice was not of individuals for salvation, but it is of nations. And he says, well, the whole context shows that's not true. Next point. He dismisses it without an argument. He dismisses it without an examination. And therefore, he sustains credibility, because if he did examine it, he would find that the passage sustains the Arminian position. It doesn't sustain his position in the context and comparing the scriptures Paul quotes and so forth. So that's a cavalier dismissal. An argument stings too much, so you pretend like it's not there or like it didn't hurt. Then there's the false analogy. I won't give examples of that necessarily. Well, I can. Here's a false analogy for you. Another one from Sproul. Since he talks more about this than most people, we get more examples from him. Sproul said, the Arminian sometimes preaches as if the sinner is a drowning man and the gospel is a life preserver thrown to the drowning man, and that all the drowning man has to do is reach out and grab the life preserver and he'll be saved. And the gospel is that way. You throw the gospel out to the people, and the sinner, just if he reaches out by faith and takes hold of the gospel, he'll be saved. But Sproul says that's a false analogy. Why? Because it doesn't correctly represent, in his opinion, the point it's trying to illustrate. It's got problems with the analogy. He says the sinner is not a drowning man. The sinner is a dead man at the bottom of the ocean, full of water. He cannot grab anything. He's dead. Therefore, he says the Arminian use of that image is a false analogy. Now, see, the Arminian says, no, it's actually Sproul who has the false analogy, because he's taking a statement that we're dead in trespasses and sins and applying it more literally than it could possibly be applied. A sinner is dead in trespasses and sins, but he's not literally dead. He's not laying at the bottom of the ocean. He's not incapable of moving his hands or his eyes or his brain. He's not incapable of making choices. Sinners make choices every day. So In other words, what he's doing is making a false analogy. He's likening the sinner to a totally dead man who can't do anything, can't think, can't breathe, can't move. That's not the picture of the sinner. You see, in this case, the question is, which analogy works? Each one accuses the other of making a false analogy, but the point is, it's an analogy. A drowning man or a dead man, one or the other, a life preserver. What's going to work? Well, the analogy is a false one, as used by one or the other side. The question, of course, which side? But that's you weaken your position by appeal to this. Let me quickly wind this down. We have about 4 minutes left, it looks like. We need to understand a concept called the burden of proof. According to the American College Dictionary, the burden of proof is, number one, the obligation to offer evidence which the court or the jury could reasonably believe in support of a contention, failing which the party will lose its case. Or secondarily, it's the obligation to establish an alleged fact by convincing a tribunal of its probable truth. The point here is, the party has to prove his point or he loses. It's not if he fails to prove his point, it's a draw. There are times, there are some debates in which neither party can prove his point and it ends up a draw. Either point seems equally possible. But there are other arguments where one point seems clearly ridiculous or contrary to common sense, and therefore if it is true, it must prove itself true against opposition, against common sense, against initial evidence. And if it fails to prove itself true, it loses. It's not just neutral. It loses because it is self-evidently self-condemned unless it can be proven right. In such a case, the burden of proof is on the party whose view would naturally be rejected unless it could be proven true. The way I've written it in these notes that I've given you is the burden of proof usually falls more heavily upon one side of an argument than upon the other. It rests predominantly upon the side that is challenging what common sense, conventional wisdom, or plain initial evidence would ordinarily suggest. Now, by the way, sometimes a proposition is true. That is challenging what common sense would suggest. Sometimes common sense could be wrong. But the position that is challenging what common sense, conventional wisdom, or plain initial evidence would ordinarily suggest is that position that has to prove itself or lose. The burden of proof rests upon that side of the argument. For example, if common sense or plain evidence suggests that a God who did not control all human decisions could not be God, then the burden of proof would fall upon the non-Calvinist debater to show convincingly that God could still be God while deferring to man's free choices. On the other hand, if conventional wisdom and common sense suggest that God could not inevitably ordain sin without becoming the responsible party for sin, or that God could not at the same time will that all men be saved while willing that some be lost, then the burden of proof in the discussion would necessarily rest most heavily upon the Calvinist debater to show conclusively that the Scriptures nonetheless affirm such things. In other words, the burden of proof rests on the person whose position is the most seemingly illogical, seemingly problematic, seemingly in contrast with the evidence. That person may yet win the debate, though his position at first glance appears to be so, but he has to prove it or lose. In my position, in my understanding, as one who has been on both sides of the issue somewhat and been very much in the middle ground for most of my life and not cared too much to prove one or the other, I would have to say as an observer that it is the Calvinist position upon whom the burden of proof most heavily weighs, because it suggests things that intelligent, rational thinking would suggest are self-contradictory, irrational, and not plainly taught in Scripture, and seems to go against things that are plainly taught in Scripture. If Calvinism is true, it must prove itself, and I believe that it has failed to do so, at least to my satisfaction. I leave to you to judge for your own satisfaction.